Welcome back. The topic of today's discussion is paste clock loop or PLL, LPC2148 microcontroller. PLL is a frequency synthesizer circuit, which means with a single reference signal, with a single frequency, the circuit can generate multiple frequencies by a closed loop feedback system.
If you see in LPC2148, the clocking scheme, you have the crystal oscillator at the extreme left. So this is my microcontroller internal periphery. So this is my MUC. To the external part of the microcontroller, we connect our crystal across the crystal pins with the two capacitors shunted to ground. This is typically in LPC2148, operates at 12 MHz. So this is the internal oscillator which is present inside your LPC2148. The output frequency of the oscillator, we call it as F oscillator. This oscillator is typically oscillating at 12 MHz. The output of this oscillator frequency is fed as an input to this PLL circuit. And the output of the PLL circuit is then supplied to your CPU. This is my CPU. The clock that is going to my CPU is called CPU clock or C clock. C clock stands for CPU clock. The typical expectation of this is 60 MHz. This is the maximum clock speed at which the LPC2148 can support. The maximum CPU clock supported by LPC2148 is 60 MHz. And then you can take that the CPU clock and then you will divide that by an appropriate divider. This divider is known as VLSI peripheral bus divider. VLSI peripheral bus divider. The job of this divider is to divide this high frequency clock, CPU clock, which is coming at 60 MHz and scale down to a suitable value, which is suitable for all the peripheral devices. So the clock that is going to all the peripheral devices is called P clock or peripheral clock. So we derive this peripheral clock by dividing this CPU clock by an appropriate figure. Normally we half this number, 60 MHz by 2. So we can supply 30 MHz or we can even half by 2, 15 MHz. So depending upon your choice, you can supply a suitable peripheral clock to all the peripheral devices. It is this P clock which supplies the clock frequency to all the peripheral devices, including GPIO, timer, UART, ADC, DAC, SPI, I2C. All the internal peripherals of LPC2148 takes this peripheral clock as input for their operation. So how do you convert this P clock from C clock is what is important. Typically, we make this peripheral clock to operate at 30 MHz off of this frequency. Or if you don't want that to happen, you can also bypass the same 60 MHz here without dividing, or you put this VLSI peripheral, the bus divider, as a 1, so that you end up in getting the same frequency as your CPU clock as well. So that is also possible. Now, where is our PLL in this entire chain? The PLL is basically fitted between the oscillator output versus the CPU clock. So this is where my PLL is present. So the PLL essentially takes a clock frequency of 12 MHz from the oscillator and it generates that to a 60 MHz output, which is supplied to the CPU as well as to the peripherals by dividing to a bus divider. So this PLL is essential, it is a closed loop circuit. This closed loop circuit essentially takes a reference input and then generates a stable output at a desired frequency. In this case, the input frequency is coming at 12 MHz from the oscillator. And the output frequency that I generate is 60 MHz that is powering my CPU as well as the peripheral. Now, going back to LPC2148, LPC2148 has actually two PLLs, PLL0 and PLL1. PLL1 is used for generating the clock for USB at a fixed frequency of 48 MHz. So this is exclusively dedicated for USB circuit. And PLL0, on the other hand, is used for generating the system clock, which is the CPU clock. And from there, we generate the peripheral clock, P clock. So what we are going to discuss today is PLL0, not PLL1. PLL0 is the one which supplies the necessary clock for both CPU as well as the peripheral. Now, the scheme diagram for PLL is shown here. The PLL takes input from the oscillator, crystal oscillator. The F oscillator is the frequency of oscillation that is coming out from the crystal oscillator. PLL generates the CPU clock or C clock, which is typically expected to operate at 60 MHz. Okay, so the job of the PLL is to convert this 12 MHz input coming from oscillator to 60 MHz. This is the range of input signal that the PLL expects for operation. So the oscillator output can range anywhere between 10 MHz to 25 MHz. Any input less than 10, any input above 25, this PLL cannot accommodate. So the input that the PLL expects should range somewhere between 10 to 25 MHz strictly, which means the oscillator output is expected to deliver anywhere between these two. In our case, we are delivering 12 MHz. So this is something that you have to understand. And I also told you that this PLL internally has a current controlled oscillator. This current controlled oscillator is the one which generates the desired output frequency, current controlled oscillator. This current controlled oscillator is the block which is used in the feedback loop to generate a desired output frequency. And the current controlled oscillator in LPC2148 operates between these two frequency limits, 156 MHz to 320 MHz. These are the two frequency limits in which this current controlled oscillator can work. And this frequency limits you have to understand clearly. The oscillator inputs that is coming from the crystal oscillator should range somewhere between 10 to 25 MHz. The frequency of current controlled operation is 156 MHz to 320 MHz. The output that is generated by the system ranges to 60 MHz max. This is the maximum limit. So this is a simple architecture that we have already discussed in the opening slide. So this is my F oscillator coming from crystal. This is coming at 12 MHz. The PLL, with the help of current controlled oscillator, generates a CPU clock at 60 MHz. The 60 MHz we take and as an input to VLSI peripheral bus divider and generate the peripheral clock or P clock. It can be 30 MHz if you divide this by a value of 2. So if you divide this by 2, you end up getting 30 MHz. If you same, you simply bypass, you also can generate 60 MHz. So that is. And the most important value that you have to understand is we have two values called multiplier and divider. This multiplier factor M, which is multiplier factor, the divider factor P decides what should be my output frequency. This multiplier factor M and the divider factor P, we make use of for appropriately configuring the PLL in order to generate the 60 MHz. Okay, so that is something that you have to understand. So there are two important equations that you have to understand with respect to PLL in LPC2148. The first equation is CPU clock or the output clock, C clock, is equal to whatever is your input frequency or F oscillator. This is the oscillation, F oscillator coming from the oscillator, multiplied by M. M refers to the multiplier factor. So whatever the multiplier factor you choose, this is the multiplier factor, multiplier. This is U. Multiplier factor. So whatever is the multiplier factor you choose, that multiplied by F oscillator will give you CPU clock. So that is my first equation. Second equation is same CPU clock, C clock is equal to frequency of current controlled oscillator, FCCO. What is, there is a CCO inside. What is the frequency of that? All divided by 2 times of P. This is another equation. P is the divider factor. This is equation 2. So my CPU clock is equal to M times of oscillation frequency, which is the frequency output coming from oscillator. The second equation is CPU clock also equal to frequency of current controlled oscillator divided by 2 types of these two equations you keep in mind. So as usual, any peripheral device, PLL is also a peripheral device. What are the important special function registers we need to use? So the designation in front of that defines which peripheral device you are using, PLL0. In case if you are using PLL1, you have to substitute that with PLL1. The first one is PLL0 feed sequence SFR, PLL0 feed sequence SFR. This feed sequence SFR is used for providing password to PLL. PLL is a very secure resource. You cannot just like that go and write some value into it. The microcontroller expects you to feed the password for entering into PLL and do certain operation for configuring and controlling that, just like your ATM card. So whenever you are having your ATM card, the moment you put your ATM card, in order to draw money from your ATM machine, you have to enter a secret password. Only then you can take. Just like that, the microcontroller expects you to enter a secret password. Only then it will allow you to do certain operations in PLL. Because anything that you do in PLL, it will affect the overall performance of the system. Since it's a very important resource, the feed sequence SFR is a password register. where you are supposed to enter the password for gaining entry into the PLL system. So that is the first SFR. Second SFR is control SFR, PLL0CON, just like TCON in 8051. This is PLL0CON. This is 0, not O. This PLL0 control register is used to enable and connect the PLL. So, okay, so this PLL control register is used to enable or disable the PLL, and it is helped to connect and disconnect the PLL to the main clocking system of our LPC214. The third important SFR is configure register, PLL0CFG. CFG stands for configure register. This register is used to appropriately set the value of M and P. What is the multiplier factor and what is the divider factor? So we have to write the values of M and P in order to have a suitable output. So this is PLL configure register. The fourth important register is the status register, PLL0 status register. This status register is used to confirm whether PLL has successfully completed delivering our desired output. Suppose 60 MHz is my desired output. I have to connect the PLL to the system only when the PLL has achieved that 60 MHz. It will take some time. Till then, we have to wait. So this status register will tell you whether the PLL has achieved the desired output or whether the PLL has achieved desired, that information we can know from it. Once we are confirmed about it, then we can connect the PLL. Last but not the least, VLSI peripheral bus divider. This divider is used to derive a suitable clock for peripheral clock from CPU clock. So from the CPU clock, which is operating at 60 MHz, we use this VLSI peripheral bus divider to divide that fellow by a suitable factor and hence generate a suitable clock frequency for peripherals, which is called PQ. Okay, so that is the five important SFRs. So let us see these registers one by one. First one is PLL feed sequence register. This PLL feed sequence register is just like your ATM pin. Why this ATM pin is necessary? To gain entry into the system. Okay, just like that, PLL feed register expects a password for gaining entry into PLL of LPC2148. So what is the password that you are supposed to give? AA and 55. So you have to give in the same value, in the same sequence. If you give 55 and AA, it won't work. So this is manufacturer defined. So I have to write AA and 55 in the same order so that PLL system can be accessed by the user. So that is the first thing. This is something similar to key to open a safe. Okay. So PLL feed equal to AA and 55, we will give in the same sequence. So this is just like gaining entry into the PLL system. That is number one. Number two, PLL control register. In the PLL control register, two bits are of important for us. Okay. All the SFRs in LPC2148 are 32 bits. Okay. So we are not dealing all the 32 bits here. Only the interested bits we are worried about. So this is bit 0 and bit 1. The first bit is called the enable bit. Okay. So this is my enable bit. So if you make this enable bit as a 1, that means PLL0 is enabled. If you make this enable bit as a 0, that means PLL0 is disabled. So this is enabling and disabling the peripheral device. This is the 0th bit of PLL0 control register. I am not discussing about the remaining bits here. 0th bit and first bit alone will discuss. The next bit is called the connect bit. In the connect bit, we used to connect the PLL to the clocking system. So if you put a 1 here, PLL0 is connected to LPC2148's clocking system, connected to C clock, let us say. Okay, so the output is, the desired output is achieved. So I take that output and connect that to CPU clock. If this is 0, when connect bit is 0, PLL0 is disconnected from the CPU. So we have to connect only when you are, when should we connect and when should we connect, disconnect. We should connect only PLL0 generates desired output of 60 MHz. So this feedback loop starts generating the output frequency. Only when it reaches 60 MHz output, we should connect the PLL. Till that point, we have to wait. So these are the only two bits that we are worried about. Rest of the bits in PLL0 control register are of not important. So these are the two bits, PLL enable bit, PLL connect bit. PLLE stands for enable, PLLC stands for connect, the first two bits. So what are the possible ways in which you can use these two bits? So if the first two bits are 00, they are disabled and disconnected. 01 means what? It is enabled, but not connected. Okay, I have enabled the PLL, but I have not connected. The final ideal condition is enabled and connected. The third SFR is PLL configure register, CFG. The PLL configure register uses M select and P select values. The M select value will have the first 5 bits. The first 5 bits are of the first 5 bits of this PLL0 configure register. So let me draw this configure register. Though this is a 32-bit value, the first 8 bits are of useful for us. So 4 and 8. So bit 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. So the first 5 bits, what are the first 5 bits? 1, 2, 3, 4, and so these 5 bits are used for M select. So first 5 bits means what? 2 power of 5. What is 2 power of 5? 32. So M select can have a maximum value of 32. And the next 2 bits, bit number 5 and 6, is used for P select. So it can have 4 possible combinations: 00, 01, 10, and 1. So these are the first 7 bits of PLL0 configure register. So how to put the values of M select and P select? Very simple. Let us pay some attention here. This is my CPU clock. What is the equation for CPU clock versus F oscillator? CPU clock, C clock is equal to M times of frequency of oscillator. Therefore, the value of M equal to what is your CPU clock divided by what is the frequency of the frequency of oscillator. What is my CPU clock requirement? In my case, I want a CPU clock of 60 MHz. What is my oscillator clock output or input of the PLL? It is 12 MHz. So 60 by 12, the value of M should be 5. The value of M should be 5. So what we normally load is, we always load M minus of 1. In the place of 5, we load 4. Why we load 4? Whatever you load, the processor will add 1 and then it will compute. Okay, so we have to load 4. Why we have to load 4? The CPU will always add 1 to whatever you load. That this is just to avoid accidental zero error. Suppose by default, if you have forgot to load M select, and if you put the value of M equal to 0, what will happen if you put M equal to 0 accidentally? If you put M equal to 0 accidentally, 0 multiplied by 12 MHz, CPU clock will take 0 MHz, which will shut down the clock input to the CPU. So that is the zero error. So in order to eliminate that zero error, the processor will always add 1 to whatever you. So if you load 4, the processor will take 4 plus 1 and it will take M select as 5. So for a value of 5, we have to load a value of 4. So this is for M select. For P select, we have to do certain computation. We know that the frequency of current-controlled oscillator works between two ranges. What is the two ranges? 156 MHz to 320 MHz. And we also know an equation. What is the equation that we know? CPU clock, C clock is equal to frequency of current-controlled oscillator divided by 2 times of P. So the value of P is equal to frequency of current-controlled oscillator divided by 2 times of CPU clock. Okay, so this is the equation. Now let us calculate the value of P for the two frequency limits. The first frequency limits, case 1, when frequency of current controlled oscillator is equal to 156 MHz, what is the value of P? P is equal to 156 MHz divided by 2 times of CPU clock. CPU clock is 60 MHz. So what is the value? I take my calculator. 156 divided by 2, again divided by 60, that is 1.3. So the first value of P is 1.3. This 1.3 is for 156 MHz. Next, we will calculate the value of P for 320 MHz. I do it here, the left hand side, case 2, when frequency of current controlled oscillator is equal to 320 MHz, what is the value of P? P is equal to 320 MHz divided by 2 times of C clock, 2 into 60. So that is equal to 320 divided by 2, which is again divided by 2.66. So the value of P for 156 MHz is 1.33. The value of P for 320 MHz is 2.66. So we have to take a round number between these two. So what is the round number between these two? The round number between these two is 2. So the value of P is 2. So these are the possible combinations of P select bits, bit number 5 and 6 for possible values of P. For value of P, the bit combination is 00. For value of P is equal to 2, the bit combination is 01. So our value of P is 2. So for P is equal to 2, the value of bits that we have to put in P select is 0 and 1 respectively. For 4 and 8, these are the bit combinations. So we are worried about this. Okay. So let us do the bit sequence for PLL0 configure register. PLL0 configure register is a 32-bit register, but I am worried about the first 8 bits. So 2, 4, and 8. So the first 5 bits, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, is M select. This is M select. And the next 2 bits is P select. Okay. So M select, we already calculated the value of M is equal to 5, but we should load 4. So load 4. So what is the value of binary 4? 0, 0, 1, 0, 0. So I put 0, 0, 1, 0, 0. So this is 4 in decimal. The processor will add 1 to it, and then it will take the value of M as 5. For P select, we have already computed the bit sequence for P equal to 2. For P equal to 0, 2, the bit sequence is 0, 1. So I will simply put 0, 1 here. This bit is not useful. So this is the sequence. So 0, 1. 0, 0, 1, 0. So what is the hexadecimal value of PLL0 configure register? So it is 0, 0, 1, 0, which is 2, 0, 1, 0, 0, which is 4, hexadecimal 24. So PLL0 configure register is equal to hexadecimal 24. That will set M equal to 5 and P equal to 2. So that is our configuration values for CPU clock of 60 MHz. The last register that we are interested in is PLL0 status register. The PLL0 status register is used to check whether the PLL has achieved the target frequency of 60 MHz or not. So how to know the target frequency of 60 MHz is achieved or not? We have a bit called lock bit. This lock bit is the 10th bit of PLL0 status register. So what I do here, if the 10th bit of PLL0 status register, if it is equal to 1, which means the PLL has achieved the target frequency. So in that case only I will connect. So the status register has a bit called a lock bit. The lock bit is present in the 10th bit of status register. So I read that value. If that value is a 1, which means if the lock bit value is a 1, so if the lock bit value is 1, that means the PLL has achieved 60 MHz. In that case, I go ahead and connect the PLL to the system. If the value of lock bit is not equal to 1, if it is a 0, that means it has not generated 60 MHz. In that case, I don't connect the PLL to the system. So I'll disconnect it. So that is the only use of lock bit. So this is the status register. Rest all bits, I am not bothered. The 10th bit alone, I am interested. 10th bit alone is called the lock bit. In more specifically, P lock bit, PLL lock bit. This P lock bit, if it is equal to 1, the PLL has generated 60 MHz. So that is the only bit that I'll check. So what are the, mute yourself on the other side, please. So what are the steps to configure PLL? First step is, in order to configure PLL, we have to use M select and P select. M select is 5, I load 4, P select value is 2. Then I apply feed sequence. Feed sequence is the password. So the microcontroller will process my configuration to PLL. Once I issue the feed sequence, the microcontroller's PLL will start generating that 60 MHz. I wait for the lock bit to be equal to 1. If the lock bit is equal to 1, then I go ahead and connecting the PLL. If it is not equal to 1, I'll wait until it is equal to 1. Because I want to be absolutely sure that the PLL has generated 60 MHz. Only then I'll connect. Once you connect, you again ask to apply the feed sequence for the microcontroller to process your record. So this is a simple function which will does the job for you. So whatever the discussion we had just now is the complete essence of this function. The first thing is PLL0 control register, I am enabling it. So this is the very first thing that I have to do. I told you already, there are 2 bits. The first bit is the enable bit. So in order to make the PLL or in order to use the PLL, it is necessary that we have to make this fellow as a 1. The next bit is the connect bit. Now we are not generating any clock output, so we make this fellow as a 0. So we alone make the enable bit as a 1. So PLL0 control bit is equal to 0, 1. 0 means 1. This fellow is a 0, this fellow is a 1. So I enabled, but not connected. So that is the first thing. The moment you enable, the next thing that you have to do is you have to generate M select and P select by using PLL0 configure register. So you have to select M select equal to 5, P select equal to 2. For M select, though it is 5, we load only 4. The CPU will add 1 to you. So M equal to 4, P equal to 2. The value of PLL0 config register is 24. 24 is 00100100. In this 8 bits, these 5 bits refers to M select. These 2 bits refers to P select. So this will give you the value of M select equal to 4, P select value equal to 2. So that is the second thing. Once you do that, immediately you have to issue the feed sequence. AA and 55 in the same order for the microcontroller to process your request. Just like inserting your ATM card and entering the pin value. The moment you do that, the PLL will start generating the CPU desired frequency of 60 MHz. We have to know whether the PLL has generated that 60 MHz. How do I know that the PLL has generated the 60 MHz? I take the status register and check the 10th bit for a value of 1. How do I check the 10th bit value of 1? I take hexadecimal 01, left shift this fellow by 10 times, and I end that with the PLL0 status register. If the answer results in a 0, what does it mean? It means that the status bit is a 0. So the lock bit is a 0. So PLock, if it is equal to 0, I put a semicolon here, I wait indefinitely. So I keep on wait till the lock bit is a 0. The moment lock bit, PLock bit becomes a 1, then this condition fails and it will come out. In that case, what is the meaning? Meaning the PLL has generated 60 MHz. It's time for us to connect the PLL to the system. How do I connect? I make the connect bit as a 1. So I make this connect bit as a 1. Already enabled bit is a 1. So we have to write a value of 3 here. 3 means it is 1-1. So if you write PLL0 control register with 3, it is enabled as well as connected to the system. Now you again issue the PLL feed sequence register for the microcontroller to process your request. So what is the sequence here? First enable the PLL, set the values of M select and P select for 60 MHz, apply the feed sequence, then wait for the PLL to generate that 60 MHz by checking the value of lock bit, then connect the PLL to the system. In this case, it is both enabled and connected. Now again, you apply the feed sequence for the microcontroller to process your request. This is the init PLL function. There is something that we have missed here. That is, we are successful in generating the CPU clock, but how to generate this P clock? Because this is already coming at 60 MHz. What is the clock that I am interested in generating? The peripherals, or what is the value of this P clock that we have to decide? Because this is very important. It is this clock which supplies to all the peripherals. So what is the value of VLSI peripheral bus divider that I have to load here in order to generate a suitable value of P clock? So if you refer this table, if VLSI peripheral bus divider takes 00, then P clock is equal to 1/4 of C clock. So if VLSI peripheral bus divider is 00, hexadecimal 00, then P clock is equal to 1/4 of C clock. If C clock is 60 MHz, in our case, it is 15 MHz. So that is the one possible combination. If you take VLSI peripheral bus divider as 01, in that case, P clock is same as C clock, which means it is 60 MHz. Third possible scenario, if VLSI peripheral bus divider is equal to 02, in that case, P clock is equal to half of your C clock, In that case, it is half of C clock, which is 30 MHz. So if you generate the third combination, 03 is not used. So you have three possible ways in which you can generate the P clock, either 1/4 of C clock or same as C clock or half of C clock. So what we are doing in our case, we would put a VLSI peripheral bus divider as 01 and generate P clock as C clock. So in our case, normally in any computing system, peripherals are expected to work below the frequency of the processor, CPU. So it is expected that you put 30 MHz or 15 MHz, but for our case, let us use 60 MHz so that it operates at the same frequency of the CPU. So in order to make 60 MHz for pre-clock, it is necessary that you have to put the VLSI peripheral bus divider as 01. So that is the last statement. So if you put VLSI peripheral bus divider as 01, then P clock is same as C clock. P clock is equal to C clock is 16. This is last. So this init PLL should be the very first function that you should be running in any LPC2148 based system. Once you call this init PLL, you are sure that the system is connected with a frequency of 60 MHz.